طيب بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. Welcome everybody to the seminar organized by IRC for smart mobility and logistics. Today inshallah ta'ala we're gonna have Dr. Ahmed Atiyah. Dr. Ahmed Atiyah is an assistant professor at the Department of Industrial Assistant Engineering here at KFUPM. His research interests are supply chain modeling and optimization, inventory and production control, quality control, eco-production scheduling, and renewable energy. His work has appeared in many journals, mashallah, tabarakallah, such as International Journal of Production Research, Quality Engineering, Computer and Chemicals Engineering, Sustainable Energy Technologies Assessment, and of course, Renewable Energy. He's an editor assistant of the Journal of Quality and Maintenance Engineering, published by Emerald in the United Kingdoms. Dr. Atiyah, mashallah, tabarakallah, is one of the active members here in the department, ISE department, mashallah, tabarakallah. طيب, today, inshallah ta'ala, we're gonna have a title of multi-objective optimization of the hydrocarbon supply chain under price and demand uncertainty. Dr. Atiyah, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Dr. Hassan, for the nice introduction. Okay, if you allow me, I'll turn my webcam.
Yes, of course. Of course, doctor.
The title of the seminar today is Multi-Objective Optimization of the Hydrocarbon Supply Chain Under Price and Demand Uncertainty. This work has been done by myself, Professor Saleh Dafua from the Department of Industrial and Systems Engineering, Dr. Ahmed Ghaysan from Department of Construction Engineering and Management, affiliated to the Interdisciplinary Research Center for Smart Mobility and Logistics, KFUBM, and has been published in the International Journal of Sustainable Engineering. The outline of the seminar will start with the introduction, what is the hydrocarbon supply chain and main definitions, the main activities of this supply chain. After that, I'll go over quickly the previous research directions and what is the main contribution of this work. Then model development, solution methodology of this model, presenting a real case study from the Saudi Arabia petroleum supply chain and sensitivity analysis to get some managerial insights. Then I will end with conclusions and future research. At the beginning, what is the hydrocarbon supply chain? It is simply an integration between four different supply chains: crude oil supply chain and crude oil product supply chain, natural gas supply chain, and natural gas product supply chain. So four supply chains. Basically, in this work, we focused on three supply chains: crude oil supply chain, from the beginning to end, natural gas supply chain, and the natural gas product supply chain. We didn't consider the supply chain of crude oil products. As we can see from this schematic representation, simplified schematic representation of the hydrocarbon supply chain, it started from gas and oil reservoirs, representing the exploration and the production of oil and gas. Then oil go to GASPs. GASPs is a short for gas oil separator plants, where gas and oil associated gas separated from oil, oil then transported for processing, refinery, sweetening. Then associated gas and non-associated gas goes to fractionation to produce different gas products. Then we end up with the distribution centers and satisfy the customer demand. Here we consider three types of demand: domestic demand, industrial demand, and international demand. These different activities of the supply chain are classified into three echelons. Echelon one, production plants. Echelon two, processing plants, processing and refining and any transformation process. And we end up at the demand terminals to satisfy customer demand. Usually in petroleum industries, they don't call it echelon one, echelon two, echelon three. They call it upstream, midstream, and downstream. Upstream is the exploration and the production. Midstream is the processing, and downstream is the customer demand satisfaction. In most petroleum companies, there is an overlapping between each stream, and there is no clear boundary between each stream. So it depends on the scope of the company. So this is the considered hydrocarbon supply chain in a simplified form. So we'll focus on crude oil supply chain, natural gas supply chain, and natural gas products supply chain, such as propane, butane, and so on. The main objectives of this research is to develop a multi-objective model, not just single objective, because the main difference between single and multiple, single provides us with a single optimal solution, just one solution. But if our problem contains multiple objectives, so we cannot achieve just one solution to give the best performance for all objectives. No, we can generate Pareto optimal, many objectives, many optimal solutions. Each solution is good or superior in with one objective function and bad with the others. So it is, there is a trade-off. If we need to improve to reduce the cost, the revenue may be reduced, so it's became bad. If we need to improve the revenue and increase it, the cost will get worse. So we need to study this trade-off among different objectives, and we consider financial and non-financial objectives. Financial objectives such as cost and budget of the company, such as the revenue to secure the enough cash flow to pay the liabilities of the company. We also consider non-financial objectives, such as one of the most important objectives is the depletion rate. We need to minimize the depletion rate of the natural resources in order to keep sufficient natural resources for the coming generation. Second objective is modeling the uncertainty of some model parameters. There are many parameters in any model. Some of these parameters are financial, some are technical parameters, okay? And some parameters are certain. We know it from the beginning of the planning period. The decision maker, for example, know what is the OPEC quota devoted for the kingdom here. It's known from the beginning, okay? It's known the gas oil ratio. It's known about the amount of the reserves. Okay, the yield of or the composition of each stream. But there are some parameters that are uncertain, such as what has occurred during the previous years about the erratic behavior in the petroleum market in terms of price. Price is uncertain parameter. Demand also uncertain parameter. So here in this model, we need to consider the uncertainty of these model parameters and their risks and effects in the final decisions. We need to reduce the risk, for example, risk of exceeding the planned budget. We have a budget for this project. We don't need to exceed this budget, or we need to mitigate the risk of not achieving the required cash flow. As we saw during the previous years, many of the petroleum companies have gone out of the business because they couldn't secure enough cash flow for their liabilities and improvement projects. Tactical planning of crude oil, natural gas, and natural gas products. Our objective here is to tactical planning means we need to decide how much to produce, how much to transport in order to satisfy demand and in order to compensate between low price and high demand, or high price with low demand, and any market scenario that may occur. And of course, it should be a realistic and a practical model. So we have utilized the hydrocarbon supply chain from the Saudi Arabia to apply our proposed model. These are the main objectives. Okay, so regarding the previous research directions, we have classified the research directions into product oriented. Most of the papers focus on crude oil. Some of the papers focus on natural gas. Very few papers considered the crude oil and the natural gas simultaneously together. Although they are interrelated, there is a relation because there is an associated gas with the crude oil. So if we increase the crude oil production, we increase the production of the natural gas. Echelons, some papers focused on the upstream production and expression, some of them on the downstream distribution to the market. Very few papers focused on the integration. And also the papers can be classified in terms of single and multiple objectives, considering uncertainty or not. So the main contribution of this paper is that we developed a multi-objective, multi-period, multi-product, and multi-echelon, and the multi-echelon in a model, considering also CO2 emissions and considering the natural resource sustainability. One of our objectives is to control the depletion rate and in the same time satisfy demand and achieve acceptable cash flow. Now, let's start the model development. The first step in the model development is, as a decision maker, when you need to take a decision, you must have a data. But in reality, not all data is clear from the beginning of the planning period. So at the beginning of the planning period, we know some data, we know some information, so we can take some decisions. After passage of time, we can realize more data. We have more data about more parameters. So we can take another batch of decisions, then realize, then decide. So it is a multi-stage process from realize data, then take decisions, and so on. This process of realize, decide can be formulated by stochastic programming. In stochastic programming, there are two main approaches, multi-stage or two-stage. In this work, we utilize the two-stage stochastic programming because we found that the network is naturally divided into two stages. As we can see here, in the first stage, which is written as first here, these are the first stage decisions. The decision maker, based on the known information, can decide how much to extract from gas and oil reservoirs after production. Gas, whether it is associated and non-associated, and oil gathered in the gathering centers. After realizing the market scenario related to price, related to the demand, he can take another batch of decisions of how much he should extract from the gathering centers to further processing and refining operations to satisfy the customer demand. So we have utilized this approach of two stages, stochastic programming. First stage that allows the decision maker to ensure that he will satisfy the demand on time. He will produce after a time and knows the market scenario, he can recurse or he can correct his decision if he was wrong from the gathering center. So it is two stages, stochastic programming, first stage and second stage is naturally divided by the gathering centers. Now, in the model development, I will go over some indices quickly just to make it easy for you to read the constraints. First, we represent the market uncertainty as set of scenarios, all possible scenarios that may happen in the market. For example, price may go up and go down. So we represent the price with different values. Demand may go up, may go down. So we can construct many scenarios and the combinations between price and the demand to represent the market behavior. Started with the capital omega here, represents the set of scenarios, can be any number of scenarios. The model accepts any number of scenarios. Pi of omega is the probability of each scenario, as we will see later, based on the parameters, we'll develop the joint probability function. O is a short for oil, G short for gas, capital T is short of planning periods. So here is some sets. As we saw in the schematic representation of the supply chain, okay, we have some activities related to oil, some activities related to gas. So any activity related to oil, we used O. Any activity related to gas, we used G as short for gas. R is short for reservoir, G for gathering centers, P for processing and refining, sweetening, whatever the transformation process. D is short for demand. Demand is classified into either local demand, industrial demand, and international demand. So this is short. We just used the first character of each activity. After that, we have two types of decisions, first stage decision and second stage decision. X represents the decisions related to oil, Y decisions related to gas. One is for first stage. Again, X for oil, Y for gas, and two for the second stage. And second stage, it depends on the scenario. So we add omega, small omega represents the scenario number, because based on the scenario, we can decide how much we can extract from the gathering centers. Plus and minus here. Plus and minus is allowed for activities with inventory, such as gathering centers. It has inventories, such as in the demand terminals, whether it's international or industrial or local demand, it has inventory. So in inventory, we may have plus, means more products there, so we have on hand, or minus means we have lower production. So we have plus and minus decisions related to especially these activities in gathering centers and demand terminals. And we have D, it is a decision variable, represents the depletion rate of reserves. Again, it's one of the most important objectives is to reduce the depletion rate, to increase sustainability, to secure enough natural resources for the coming generations. After that, these are the decisions. That's just X and Y. X for oil, Y for gas. After that, there are some parameters related to some technical parameters, cost parameters. For example, technical parameters, here we have yield. Yield represents the composition of the stream. For example, gas, we have a stream of gas. We have gas line. What is the composition of it? What is the percentage of propane, butane, and whatever the gas product? Oil, we have a crude oil pipeline. What is the type of this oil? Is it, for example, here in Saudi Arabia, there are four. Is it extra light or medium or heavy or light, or what is the type? Okay, and we have gas oil ratio, gas oil ratio for the oil stream at the beginning. We have to separate gas from oil. After that, we have capacity parameters. What is the capacity of each planet we have? What is the capacity of route? So capital C represents the planet capacity. Small c represents the route capacity connecting all activities in the network. Volume parameters, we have information about reserves if we need to control the depletion rate. And so we have to know what are the reserves in the kingdom or based on the case study. C maximum here represents the maximum allowable limit of CO2 emissions. So one of the constraints, we consider the CO2 emissions. If it is increased above a certain limit, we have to reduce the production, or this is the limit of production. OPEC quota, this is the quota for the kingdom. It is known from the beginning. It's one of the certain parameters. After that, we have some financial parameters, cost parameters, such as E is short for extraction, or here I try to use E because we have the BC. After that, processing. We have production cost is the first stage. After that, processing cost. After that, transportation cost. So three costs. We have cost per unit of emitting CO2 to emissions, dollar per cubic feet. And also cost parameters related to above and below production in the inventory, the inventories, gathering and demand terminals. We have a cost of key of producing more than what we need. And we have a cost of minus cost of shortage. And of course, it is higher than the cost of holding. Demand and the price, the parameters, we know the values of the demand during the planning period. Okay, also it depends on, it is a scenario based. We have price parameters, it is scenario based for each product and for each gas and oil products. And of course, since it is a multi-object, it is a multi-period model, we have to discount it back and our calculations based on the present cost and the present equivalent to present. So before formulating the constraints and objectives, okay, there are two approaches in the stochastic programming can be used. The first one is we can use node variable formulation or scenario variable formulation. In the node variable formulation, okay, the number of decision variables here, it depends on the number of nodes and the number of planets we have. But on the other hand, for scenario variable formulation, number of variables depends on the number of scenarios. So if we have 100 scenario, each decision variable in the first stage will be a 100 decision. But here in the node variable formulation, each decision variable in the first stage will be as is, will be just one decision. So we used the node variable formulation in order to formulate a simple model, lower number of decision variables. And of course, we utilized the recent advances in the available software so it can solve the model without decomposition. But there is another idea is that anyone can use scenario variable formulation, because based on scenario variable formulation, the model is naturally decomposed. So you can solve small models if you couldn't solve a big model. So we prefer the first way, which is the concise model, node variable formulation. Now let's start with the constraints. Constraints here, there are 8 sets of constraints. The first set of constraints related to the material balance constraints. Material balance constraints means what? Means input equals output. Amount of input equals amount of output. Should be balanced. So material balance constraints here for the second echelon, for the processing, for the gas oil separations, for transformations, not for first and third echelons. So for the oil plants, there are set of material balance constraints, okay, for gasps, for processing, and for the gathering centers, we can see here that we have added the plus here from T minus one means the amount of input plus the end inventory from the previous period equals the amount of output plus the end inventory of that period T. That balance considers the inventory. For the gas, the same for gas, also in the second echelon, and we consider the gas gathering centers where there is an inventory. Second set of constraints, plant capacity constraints, each plant has a limited capacity. So we have to limit the input stream to its known capacity. One of the certain parameters, we know the capacity, for example, gasps, we know the capacity of the gasp. So the total input to the gasp should be limited to this capacity. And we have capacity for, of course, here capacity constraints for second and third echelons, because second and third echelons have input to it. Now gas planets, capacity of gas planets. And of course, the capacity here for gathering centers, for example, considers the input from the gas reservoirs directly, inputs from the associated gas from gasps, plus the end inventory from the previous period. Third set of constraints is about root capacity constraints, the amount of transported quantities, which is crude oil or natural gas, is of course limited. There's pipelines here in the kingdom, so we have limited capacity for the connections between first and the second activities in first and second echelon, and from second to third echelon. Fourth set of constraints is regarding to demand constraints. Demand at the international, domestic, and industrial terminals. And since there is inventory allowed in the demand terminals, so here we consider the inventory from the previous period, and also we consider the shortage that may occur. We may face shortage. Maybe, for example, we have a scenario during any planning period, the demand went up. So we may face shortage. Fifth set of constraints is OPEC quota constraint. OPEC quota constraint is related to the international demand terminal. It is limited with the OPEC quota. Constraint is the environmental regulation constraints about the total gas emissions. Total, here we consider just CO2, total CO2 emissions from the whole hydrocarbon supply chain network should be limited with this number, which is the Cmax, which is a parameter. It is input from the decision maker over all scenarios. Seventh, sustainability constraints. Sustainability constraints here, we can see here it is D, represents the depletion rate. We should limit the depletion rate. Depletion rate here measured as division or comparison between X, which is amount of production or extraction, over the proven reserves at the beginning of the planning period. So production or extraction over the reserves, and last set of constraints is non-negativity constraints. All decision variables should be positive. Three objective functions have been considered in this work. First, minimize total cost to limit to control the budget. Second, total revenue to secure the enough cash flow, the inflow to the company, to secure for the company the continuity. And the third one, which is the depletion rate. The total costs considered here, production costs, processing costs, and the transportation costs for both second and third stage, first stage and second stage. And since it's multi-period, we discount it back to time zero. And of course, we have cost of carbon emission to the atmosphere. Second objective is revenue. It is simply the price times amount of production, or the amount satisfied, the amount of demand satisfied. And the third objective is the depletion rate. We need to minimize the depletion rate. And in order to use multi-objective, the objectives should be conflicting. As we can see here, cost and revenue are conflicting objectives. Okay, we cannot optimize both simultaneously. So there is a trade-off. Regarding the solution methodology, I will go over it just quickly. I will not go into details. The utilized approach here, we use the improved version of e-constraint method, which is a famous method, and improved the method of this one, which has been published in 2013, called augmented epsilon constraint, which is this method guarantees the production of efficient Pareto optimum. After that, the efficient Pareto optimum, as a decision maker, he has flexibility to choose. He has many solutions. Some solutions are good in terms of cost. Some solutions are good in terms of revenue. Some solutions are good in terms of depletion rate. So he can choose which one. So here we used a technique from the multi-criteria decision-making technique called TOPSIS. TOPSIS is a short for technique by similarity to ideal solution, where we rank the solution based on the preference of the decision maker, whether he prefers total cost, or he prefers the revenue, or he prefers the depletion rate. Just assign a weight to each function, so the generated Pareto will be ordered from the best case to the worst case. This model, this proposed model, and these two approaches have been applied to a real case study from Saudi Arabia. The collected data from Aramco publications, from governmental publications, from the websites of the projects, unofficial meetings, and unofficial collection of data. Okay, we found these numbers of reservoirs, oil and gas, processing the planets and transformations, information about how many local terminals, how many industrial cities, how many international terminals. I will skip the network. And also based on the collected data, we found the distribution of Arabian extra light, Arabian light, Arabian medium, Arabian heavy, the proven, the reserves amount, the local demand, which type, international demand, We considered in this work the gas products as in industrial regions, the demand is methane and ethane for international terminals. These are the requirements as gas products, domestic regions, these are the gas products. Then in scenario construction, we have considered two uncertain parameters. We can consider more, but in order to make the model, we can solve it. Here we consider the international price as uncertain parameter, and we consider the three levels of it, high, medium, and low. Each one has assigned with a weight, higher weight to the base price. We considered also domestic demand as uncertain parameter. So we have also high, medium, and low with a certain probability. And also we considered that the international price and the domestic demand are going independently in order to generate the joint probability distribution. So we ended with 9 scenarios of the market behavior in terms of international and domestic demand. 9 combinations, for example, high price, high demand, or base price with high demand, and so on with these probabilities. So after feeding the model with these parameters and this network, we applied the multi-objective approach, which is the augment epsilon. Okay, we have generated 154 efficient Pareto optimum. Efficient Pareto means it's feasible, doable, can be applied. As mentioned, some of these are good in terms of cost, some others in terms of depletion, and so on. We represented the produced efficient Pareto as this surface. We can see that the horizontal axis, we have this axis represented the reserve sustainability in years, as a number of years. We have this axis revenue as million of dollar per 3 months. Here the planning period is 3 months and discretized into 1 month. So we have 3 months. The reason behind using 3 months is that Aramco renews the contracts every 3 months. So it's based on the case study. Total cost in the vertical axis, we can see that, for example, this point is a possible solution. This point gives very high total cost, very low revenue. Okay, very high total cost. Total cost here high because of the shortage, not because of the production. We have high shortage. We didn't produce enough, but give a good sustainability, longer years, longer sustainability. For this one, if we need to reduce the total cost and increase the revenue, the sustainability will get worse. So the multi-objective gives the decision maker flexibility to choose among the different alternatives. Then also this model provides a break-even point. We can specify the break-even points, the amount of oil and gas productions, such as that the income, cash flow, the revenue can cover the total expenses, the total cost we can see here. And we can see also here in the vertical axis, this dark red represents the gas production. This blue line represents the oil production. There is a relation between oil and gas production. As we increase oil production, we reduce the non-associated gas production because we already produce gas, the associated gas. After that, we have compared between the multi-objective stochastic versus multi-objective deterministic, which is published previously, and we can compare between the results that the stochastic, since we consider many market scenarios, we consider worst case conditions, we can see the total cost is higher, revenue is lower, but sustainability is better. Production of oil in terms of million barrel per day is lower, and the gas production may be cut it to a half. So considering the uncertainty and considering different market scenarios. Here is a comparison between the solution from the deterministic model in blue and stochastic model, or considering uncertainty in red. Okay, usually the stochastic model gives expected solutions, the average solution compromising between different scenarios. Here is also natural gas. We found that we faced the shortage of natural gas. We applied some sensitivity analysis by assigning different probabilities to, for example, we assigned high probability to high price, in the same time, high probability to low demand, because usually they are related to each other, high price and the demand will get low, and generated, this is case two, generated again nine scenarios, another case with nine scenarios, okay? These are the results. Finally, in the conclusion, this work provides a multi-objective, which is real problems in the real world. It is a multi-objective because you have two, there is a trade-off among the objectives, financial objectives, non-financial objectives. We take tactical decisions, how much to produce, how much to transport, how much to keep in inventory, what we should do if this scenario occurred, what we should do in this scenario occurred, and so on. Here also we consider the environmental impact. We limit the CO2 emissions. Okay, so we control the CO2 emissions, and I think in the future it will be applied. It will not unlimited, it should be limited. We can get the break-even production in order to know what is the range of production from oil or from gas that we can achieve profit. Here's a comparison between deterministic and stochastic. Finally, about our future research, it is very interesting to check design scenarios such that consider the dependency between the parameters. There's a dependency between oil and the gas. In order to do this, we have to collect more data. We have to meet with the stakeholders in order to see what is the relation, how we can generate the probability and construct the joint probability distribution. Second, future research, which is ambiguity of risk attitude. In this problem, we assume that we are risk neutral. Okay, we are getting the solution based on the expected value, multiplying the probability times the value, but we don't know. Maybe the decision maker is risk taker. Maybe he is risk avoider. We don't know. So there are some techniques, some formulations allows to get a robust solution, although you don't know the risk of the decision maker. The final thing is that also it is interested to develop an integrated hydrocarbon supply chain in order to consider the crude oil products to make it complete. Okay, that's the end of the presentation. Thank you for your listening. Now I'm waiting for any questions or comments for maybe future research or something to improve.
Thank you, Dr. Ahmed Atiyah, for this informative presentation as usual. I would like to open the floor for questions, if you have any questions. Yes, we have seven attendees here. Do you have any questions? طيب انا I have one question. Mashallah, tabarakallah, you said about the hydrocarbon and those kind of things. What is the, if we would like to include the carbon footprint in this kind of supply chains, and I'm sure that you heard about the carbon footprint in the supply chain. Where do we stand for these kind of things, carbon footprint in the supply chain currently with the hydrogen, basically?
The carbon footprint is basically, it is Cmax. Here it is the maximum allowable emissions of CO2. We can consider it as a maximum allowed footprint, carbon footprint of this network. But of course it is incomplete, to be honest with you, because in some hydrocarbon supply chains, they don't use just pipelines in order to transport the crude oil or gases or liquefying gases and transport it. Sometimes they use trucks, they use tankers. So there is an emission. So in order to make it a comprehensive model, I think we have to consider multi-modes of transportation, not just the pipelines. And we have to consider also the footprint of the transportation. So the consider the footprint here is just CO2 emissions from the processing and transformation from the planets itself.
Okay, that is great. Type. Thank you, Dr. Atiyah. The second question is that now, in your model, basically we have multi-objective model, right? Mm-hmm. There is another technique in optimization. They call it bi-level optimization. Can we say if we, instead of solving all the objective together as a multi-objective optimization, can we, let's say, solve one objective at a time and then we modify accordingly? They call it robust, I guess, robust optimization.
Robust optimization. Actually, I published a paper. I solved this model formatted as a robust optimization.
Robust optimization.
Yeah. I have a published paper. I can share it with you. Same model, same case study. Actually, myself and Dr. Aysan, Professor Saleh Dafoua, we solved this network deterministic, stochastic, risk, and robust. I focused on this part of the network, and Dr. Aysan focused on the crude oil, the complement of the network.
The complement of the network. MashaAllah, tabarakallah. That is.
But according to the technique you mentioned, actually, I don't have enough information about it. I have to read about it. Okay, but usual robust based on the, we have multiple scenarios and we need to generate just one solution that is robust against these variations. It's done. I did it.
That is great. طيب, the last question, just if the others, they don't have questions. Now, we have this kind of a multi-objective optimization and those kind of things. If we would like to fit artificial intelligence in this kind of a supply chain, where do we start basically? What do you think?
I don't know. Which technique do you mean?
Usually, as you can see here, we solve the optimization problem as a one set, right? But in general, this kind of a supply chain, it is a kind of a dynamic problems, right? Yes. Changing with time. Now, nowadays they use artificial intelligence techniques to, let's say, to connect these echelons together, to connect these stakeholders together, and so on. So where do we stand between optimization and artificial intelligence? Handling this kind of problems, we can see it, we can handle it through an OR, not OR, from one side, as you said, optimization. And the other side, we can see it using an artificial intelligence, machine learning and those things, to do exactly the same.
Frankly, I don't have enough experience with the artificial and the machine learning. Okay, so, but we can formulate the problem as a dynamic problem. and maybe I can sit with you and maybe brainstorm to formulate it in a way such that we can be solved with artificial intelligence, because the data is here. We have the data, we have all what we need. So I think maybe it's something promising or interesting to make it is a dynamic, since it is a dynamic in
it is dynamic by nature. It is dynamic by nature.
Dynamic, yes.
Yes, okay. That is great. That is great, Dr. Atiya. Have any other questions from the audience? It seems, you know, we don't have any other questions. Thank you, Dr. Ahmed Atiya. Thank you for this informative presentation, as usual. MashaAllah, tabarakAllah, great work, great presentation. Thank you so much, Dr. Ahmed Atiya.
You are welcome. Thank you, Dr. Haysam, and thank you for the attendees for listening. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Assalamu alaikum.